You're listening to the Unsung Podcast, where we talk about albums that we think are unsung classics, and then you guys tell us if you're right or wrong. This is the Unsung Podcast.
Let's fucking do it, guys.
Hi, you're listening to the Unsung Podcast. I'm your host, Mark Fraser, and I'm joined by the two men who will be the last surviving characters in a play about Brexit.
Playing Michael Gove to the right of me, Mr. Chris Cusack. What was that?
And playing the owner of Witherspoon's Pubs to my left is David Weaver.
Hi.
I'm a big fucking idiot. Hello. I'm a big fucking idiot that looks like a grey lion.
We serve gammon.
both senses.
Exactly.
Man, that is really true. We serve gammon to gammon.
Yeah. Where did gammon come from? I don't know where. I know where it
pigs.
Means. But don't.
Hey.
Hey, nice one. You can't say that. Don't offend Dave.
They can say pigs.
No, you can't. I can't say anything anymore.
If I can't see pigs, how will he know what to be angry about?
Stop virtue signaling. where did the term gammon come from? I don't know.
The name of the food.
No, but they call.
No, it was a Twitter thing. Like somebody called Brexit people gammon. It happened about 2 years
because
ago.
Because they're pink and angry, and they're all salty.
But so are a lot of fucking Scotsmen.
Also, gammon's just shite. Like angry, kind of tanned or sunburnt English tourists in Magaluf complaining about fancy Spanish food.
British food, yeah.
I think it makes a lot of sense.
I'm not saying it doesn't make sense, just that I was just curious as to where it came from.
Plus, gammon is shite. If you do make the decision to eat meat, then
don't do gammon. It's just gammon. Shit bacon, yeah. Isn't it?
it's really thick,
fucking
shite bacon.
Cack. And it's almost certainly the kind of animal product that tastes most like human flesh.
Mm. Yeah,
I mean,
definitely.
I've not checked that thesis.
But you can't imagine. And also, they always put a fucking pineapple on it. What's that?
That does happen quite a lot.
Yeah. Or a fried egg.
Fried egg.
Oh, that's bogan.
I hate fried eggs. I do not miss eggs at all. And well, fried eggs are the worst.
I eat eggs, but I have to admit, I have a love-hate relationship with fried eggs and poached ones, especially if they're not cooked properly all the way through and they're that wobbly stuff.
Yeah. I quite like a fried egg. A poached egg has to be perfect and it can be quite difficult for a lot of places to achieve. Scrambled eggs can get right in the fucking bin. Eat that shit.
See, scrambled egg was the type of egg that I could eat. Mm. I never liked eggs since I was little and everybody thought I was a freak because everybody seems to fucking love eggs. I have no idea why, because what is the worst type of fart? It's an eggy fart. Mm. So why would you want to eat something that smells like the worst type of fart?
I would say a wet fart's worse than an eggy fart.
Aye, but you can't to smell. You can't tell if it's wet or not from the smell.
Is it worse than a fanny fart?
What was it? Custard cousins last week, fanny fart this week. See, welcome to Being 13 with Chris Cusack.
This is why we'll never be in the BBC. Plus, we know things about music.
Yeah.
Oh, we fucked it. I entirely fucked it.
Plus, we don't talk about the same, you know, 10 bands ad infinitum.
Oh, don't be sour, Christopher. You're being sour.
You've seen that with a straight face.
No.
Well, anyway, you know what, the egg thing.
Eggs, I think, fuck off, but scrambled egg was the only one I could eat.
Omelettes are so fucking good, man.
Nah, omelettes are
yeah, Spanish, the tortilla Espanol is amazing.
Fried French toast.
French toast is fucking brilliant.
Banging, man.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Dave, you're wrong.
No, I like French toast.
Pancakes? You don't have them in pancakes, I suppose.
They're in them. Well, they should
be. Yeah, I mean, I don't mind it as an ingredient, or I didn't, like, used to. Like, mayonnaise. I fucking love mayonnaise. Didn't put me off eggs.
The consistency of that freaks a lot of people out. Many, yeah. Including members of your audience.
Yeah, and me. Members in the room.
Really, you're not a big mayo fan?
Mayo? I hate mayo so much, man.
That's weird. I fucking love mayonnaise.
I'm intolerant of vegan mayo.
Really?
You found out.
What is it?
I found out. Yeah.
Oh, yeah, I remember
detriment
that.
At a nearby restaurant.
What is it?
I don't even know. I don't go near any of the variations.
It's a lack of gammon.
You know, I think the eggs thing, right? The egg thing is really interesting because clearly the problem with eggs is that they're grinding up all these baby male chicks, and that's the that's the horror of it. So they'd like developed this process by which they could now X-ray eggs and chromosomally identify what the egg was going to be, male or female. And it's so I'd kind of had this conversation as well, and it
was this before or after this transubstantiation conversation?
It's sort of concurrent. Most of my conversations are concurrent, is in an ever-growing list of people that no longer accept my calls.
But our company.
But the eggs thing was interesting because you know, there's this research and this new development where they're like, oh, we can tell what gender, what sex.
Don't assume.
We can say sex, I think, in the case of eggs. That an egg's going to be, and therefore we can destroy it before you're destroying a chick. And that then led to this outrage of like, oh, but you're destroying unborn baby chicks. I was like, sorry, are you pro-life? And it became this really odd argument where I was talking to people who are ostensibly really left-wing in most of their beliefs, including their veganism. And then they suddenly had gone super pro-life in the notion that somehow destroying an unborn male chick, thereby preventing suffering, was ethically wrong. And it was like, I have gone through the looking glass here. Like, surely that is the solution that we're looking for, which is that male chicks don't have to be destroyed, and therefore,
or just, you know, don't eat eggs.
Well, yeah. a lot of people in the world would
I know. I'm in a privileged position where I'm able to blah blah blah. I know.
But that egg argument really was an eye opener, because it was honestly people who I know are ardently pro-choice who then were literally making a pro-life argument.
Yeah, anti chicken abortion.
Yeah, really odd.
If you're lucky enough to have seen Chris Cusack with his top off, you will notice that on his stomach he has got "I hate vegans" tattooed across it.
I don't hate. What the fuck is that all about? I absolutely, completely sympathise with the arguments. Actually, I think there's a very good case.
But it was worth it just for that reaction alone.
Oh my god, man!
You've got "I love gammon" on really the back of your knees.
I don't want that to take. It could be further from the truth. As with many things, I have issues with the methodology, but not the state of dames. I think they make a lot of sense.
And gammon, not like gammon, anti-gammon.
You fucking antagonist! Fuck off! It's leaving your week, right, David? This is your week. Shut this guy
up. It's my week.
Shut this guy up.
Oh yeah. So this week I'm choosing a record that I don't know. Like, it's not a lot of people will have heard it.
This is one of the purest exercises in the unsung podcast that we've had, probably since that time you also picked an extremely it was Fritz that picked Traindodge.
Yeah, Traindodge.
That was the next most obscure record I think we've covered
while. Anyway,
the big reveal,
so it's a band called Shels, and you have to type it out, asterisk SHELS, one L, Shels, and the album is their debut record, Sea of the Dying Dhow.
Dhow is spelled D-H-O-W.
Yeah.
David's
word. Dhow is a traditional Arabic boat. Fishing boat.
Yeah. Ah, okay.
I remember first learning about dhows from Michael Palin and Around the World in 80 Days. My parents had part one on video, but didn't have part two, so I never found out if he actually got there.
My goodness. that's cruel and unusual treatment.
Yeah, but he I think he went from Somalia to the Arabian Peninsula via Dhow.
So, as it happens, as you may remember if you listen week upon week, last week we had some real problems with electrical interference. For this week's recording, which is actually happening just shortly after the last one, it's not really
giving away the secret.
We have switched off every appliance, in the hope of eliminating said interference, and we are therefore in a technological blackout. So we cannot look up and find out whether Michael Palin actually did make it. So if
he is now an Eight of the Realm, so he clearly made it.
But yeah, I'm pretty sure he made it, but I don't know if he made it in the 80 days or...
Exactly. You know, so if you can let us know... There you go. This is like one of those competitions where you phone in, it's like, was Abraham Lincoln a famous baseball player? But yeah, Michael Palin, did he make it in 80 days?
Just to follow Chris's point on that, you have to let us know, because as soon as we finish recording this episode, we're going to completely fucking forget. So please let us know.
That's also true. But yeah, we're in the midst of a technological blackout. Everything is aff at the wall, as we'd say, which is also a bit of a training exercise for March the 29th.
March the 29th, yeah, when the internet goes out, when the food goes out, yeah. When the electricity goes out.
When we finally have the Millennium Bug, just, you know, like 19 years later.
Yeah. I can't wait.
I'm excited for it. I think it's going to be a really pure time.
Yeah, I've been...
Do you mean pure in a... paleo kind of way.
I mean, yeah, we'll be following some really strict diets, I think.
Yeah, I've been stockpiling half price packets of Pringles over the festive sales period, so if anybody needs Pringles.
You see, there's a guy who had, I seen in the news the other day, there's a guy who had 5,000 packets of pasta stockpiled
in his house. They're all out of date. And then he just started gifting them to random people. Like, so like people would arrive at their house and there was a packet of 2-year-old pasta, and they were just like, what is this? And he just like put them out, and he was like really just to the point about it, about, you know, all these people need pasta, you know, it's better than a food, it's not a food bank, it's like a food, this is food banking. And we're like, what? And then somebody else, like somebody who said that they'd got one at the front door said, and I started to think that maybe it was like a gang thing. And if I took the pasta in, then they'd know that somebody was in that house. But if I left it out, then they'd think it was an empty house. So they might try and break in, or, you know, it was some sort of signal to the gangs.
Hey, Tony, don't make me leave the linguine on your doorstep and it's a Tuesday, okay?
You're allowed to do that accent, aren't you?
Yeah, I have Italian family and Italian flatmate who's... the most bizarre and hilarious stereotype you'll ever encounter anyway. And called Luigi.
He is called Luigi.
Boom. So yeah, so Shell's album is one of the most purest exercises, and I was snatching something from some level of obscurity. I mean, the band have got, what, 10,000 plus followers on Facebook, I think, but that's reasonably low
hundreds
level.
Hundreds of thousands of listens and some other tracks on Spotify.
Yeah, it was like 5,000 a week or something like that. So it's not... it's not bad.
Yeah, but they haven't released anything for 8 years.
This was their first album.
First album.
Released in 2007.
Yeah.
Their first EP by the band, which was Wings for Their Smiles.
Yeah, all one word.
All one word.
It came out in 2004.
Right.
But the band kind of came out of another band, a band called Mahumodo, who were around in the sort of early 2000s. And they were part of that sort of, that interesting UK heavy alternative music scene.
Yeah.
That a lot of interesting things came out of. And some stuff totally faded away, and then some stuff evolved and became huge.
And there were a couple of labels at the time, like,
yeah,
labels like Lockjaw and stuff doing some
Lockjaw, Undergroove,
just regenerated.
Undergroove, yeah, Undergroove. For these guys are associated with to some extent.
Yeah,
Lockjaw are still going. They've just they've just hired a bunch of new people and are like sort of rebooting almost.
So Mehdi Safa, is that right?
Mehdi Safa, yeah,
came from Mahumodo, and Tom Harriman.
He's American, and
yeah, they're classed as
relocated
British American rock band.
Yeah, I think he moved over to Britain for a few years in Mahumodo, and then moved back to the States, sort of mid 2000s, kind of mid Shells, And I think they recorded their second record like from both sides of the Atlantic and stuff like that.
And in a nutshell, excuse me, Mahumodo had an EP called Shels, didn't they?
Yeah.
Yeah.
They also, in I think 2002, they started a record label called Shels Music.
Yeah, which is, so he ended up releasing most of their stuff through that. The first record was also through Undergroove. But the Shels Music has actually got some really, really interesting stuff on it. I think as I mentioned back in the Willhaven episode, Black Sheep Wall and Admiral Angry.
Admiral Angry,
two records that I mentioned who are just unbelievably, you know, sort of heavy, doomy, sludgy stuff. Also a band called Latitudes. Released their first EP and first two albums, I think, on that album. And they're like really, really, really good sort of post-rock stuff. And there's actually a whole load of stuff from this sort of scene that I don't know, I kind of got into and have considered, you know, about bringing to the podcast.
Yeah, there's a lot of names that crop up when you're researching this band. Yeah. Actual bands that we would make the, that we've put forward just in discussions and that would probably make the cut. Now, as far as I understand it, Mehdi Safa considers this largely a project of him and Harriman, and they have other musicians that come in and work around them. It's not so much a typical band setup. Seems to be somewhere in between. Although I know they worked to a good extent with Simon Davis and is it Phil Buck? Mm-hmm. It's B-U-C-H. I don't know how that's pronounced, but I'm going to say Buck of Eden Maine.
Yeah.
Were another pretty highly regarded, albeit only moderately active, British kind of
incredible band. Though.
What would you describe them as? They were like post metal as well, but
post-hardcore. They kind of had a scramsy sort of vibe to them as well.
Yeah,
like that sort of like
early screamo vibe.
I feel like basically Eden Maine took Fault and Fracture and Concubine by Converge and tried to make that a band. A bit more chaotic.
Crunchier, I would say. Yeah. Bits of like the kind of that kind of weird Iron Monkey sort of disregard for things being too clean and precise.
Yeah. And then they're on their album, like they had an EP in the Cold Light, I think it's called, which was really like that. And I just think the drums on that record are incredible.
Cool.
Their album was a lot more post rock, actually. They had some big sort of progressive pieces on their album. It was a lot less chaotic and screamo.
Yeah, I remember liking Eden Maine, and I didn't think, when we mentioned them before I'd even looked into them again, I, in my head they weren't just a kind of straight up band, they were a lot more interesting. I think one of them also played in that band Devil Sold His Soul.
Yeah, Mahumodo basically split into two and became Shels and Devil Sold His Soul. So I think at least two members went down that route.
Can I just say there's a live video by Devil Sold His Soul. It's a studio session somewhere of the song An Ocean of Lights.
Yeah.
And it has the worst beard and I've seen some bad beards, man. And I'm sorry, the guy that's the singer in that band, you're not by any means a bad singer and the band's fine, but oh my fucking goodness. I hope one day you look back on that with the shame it deserves. It is absolutely humming. Mm-hmm. Humming. That was a real takeaway lesson.
Well, it's good that you learned something.
Yeah.
That first Devil Sold His Soul record was also another one I was thinking about bringing here. Because I think
that released on Visible Noise the same time as the first Lost Prophets record.
Possibly. No, it was way later. It was 2000 and 2007, I think.
Was it?
Yeah, it came out about the same time as this, because I remember both albums coming out and they were both former Mahumodo, and I'd never heard of Mahumodo before. And that Devil Sold His Soul is a really fucking tight record. It is post-rock, but it's kind of like put through a like metalcore dynamic.
You know, I'm kind of glad you didn't bring it, because I think... I did listen to a fair bit of it, actually. I listened to a lot of the stuff of the bands that kind of were tangential to these guys. And I think Devil Sold His Soul could be really good. And then they lapse into these sort of schmaltzy, emo-y sung passages that are so of that time.
Yeah,
are really alienating. Like they don't just go through with the heavy bits. Like An Ocean of Light's a great song, actually, for most of it. And then there's this bit that you're like, oh, it's so dated and whiny. And
there's a couple of, and their second record, like I think their second track has like a really sort of upbeat, emo-y bit in it. And it kind of worked at the time, but I don't think it's aged particularly well.
Yeah.
It's kind of naive.
So just before we go too far ahead, the first EP, that Wings for Their Smiles, 2004, it's totally fine. Have you guys heard much of it?
And then they kind of re-released it.
They remixed it. It's got like a bunch of ambient tracks, and then there's like I think it's like three proper, what you could maybe call proper songs. It's kind of like metallic post-rock more so than anything. Then there was the album, but then after the album, they put out the second EP, I think pronounced Laurentians Atoll in 2007. And that has three of the remastered tracks from that original. It has one kind of longer, it says it's like a full length version of the song Water from the album.
Yeah, but it's actually shorter.
Yeah,
which is weird.
Yeah, I couldn't figure that one out. And then four new songs, one of which, by the way, is actually, I think, right up there with some of their best, a song called City of the Swan.
Yeah,
really, really good song. It's odd. Did you also pick up on the fact that they have a song called Atoll on every single release they've ever put out?
Yeah,
it's weird that.
There's something about like their entire sort of aesthetic and everything that they go is sort of kind of dreamscapey or dreamy, or it's like to do with deserts or desert islands or something like that. And like obviously an atoll is like a little... beachy island. So
are we going for what an atoll actually is? It's a ring-shaped coral reef.
Do you want to know an atoll fact?
Please do. Is it the Bikini Atoll?
Yes, the flag. Have you ever seen the Bikini Atoll flag?
No, hit me up.
Oh, it's fucking incredible, right? So Bikini Atoll was the group of Pacific islands that were depopulated by the American army to do some nuclear testing in the 50s and 60s.
Diego Garcia, I believe, was one of them.
And so they all got moved to islands about 150 miles away.
Some of them just got literally sent out to sea. 3,000 people just like, there you go, guys, there's a boat. And they were sent towards the mainland, and they ended up arriving on shores. They didn't even know what country it was.
And I mean, Bikini Atoll is what the bikini is named after. They're famous for that. But if you look at their flag, it is the stars and stripes.
On fire.
No, pretty much. But the stars, it's got the same number of stars as islands that they have. Then they've got, I think it's something like, they've got like three black stars up on their top right and then two black stars down on the bottom right. Yeah. And that's to do with like the original islands are the ones up at the top, and the two islands at the bottom are the ones that they're far away. So it signifies the distance. And then there's like another number of stars to do with the islands that have been destroyed by the nuclear testing. And then also it's got a big fucking quote right in the middle of one of the white stripes that's like, I can't remember what it is. We should be able to Google this, but we're living in a dungeon
in a blanket,
for this one. But you should check it out. It's a really, really interesting flag. And Bikini Atoll, I mean, like they've just changed their flag to fucking hell, America, you fuck you.
It should
it's
be,
amazing.
It should really be an upside down stars and stripes shaped like a polygon to illustrate mutation due to radiation.
Yeah, exactly.
with a giant 10,000 times hotter than the sun star in the middle of the blue bit, and then the red lines running like blood.
Yeah, that would be pretty
good. And then on fire.
Well, maybe we can update it. Maybe you can send your Photoshop skills to them. Say, hey guys, it's been 30 years since you changed your flag.
Stop pussyfooting about here. Yeah,
come on.
So yeah, good fact, good.
But anyway,
deviation.
Yeah.
Don't get that. You wouldn't get that in a BBC music podcast.
We'll be right back.
We're recording this last week, just to be open. Sorry for interrupting there. That's very out of nowhere for you guys. But we don't know what's happening with Brexit, and we still seem to have Theresa May's government.
Well, by this point...
At this point...
We could have an army of chimps.
Well, yeah, that's true. But the pound keeps dropping in value. So we need to buy little things like mics and chairs and wires
toilet
and
paper,
batteries.
Rice.
Toilet roll.
We need to stock that. We need to stockpile.
If you could send us euros, that would be absolutely ideal. Or yen.
Yen. Yeah.
Or
dollars, even.
Canadian dollars. Norwegian dollars.
Pesetas.
Yeah, fuck it, anything but the pound. It really truly is appreciated if you can send us any money at all. You can go to unsungpod.net/donate.
Yeah.
Just in the drop down box, check ancient Sumerian
tokens marked with the face of an ox. What was it? Cistercian, that was the Roman one, wasn't it?
You said that like obviously you
know obviously. Did you not read Asterix when you were little? But yeah, if you can help us out, we do this in our spare time, and we have no money, so please give us some. Anyway, thanks very much.
Cigarettes and bottle caps also accepted.
To build a raft of cigarette butts.
Cigarettes.
To float our way to mainland Europe. Cheers.
Thanks, bye. So, but yeah, I think obviously Mehdi's like the sort of the leader of the band, and there's something about the whole, you know, the artwork that they do, his lyrics, it's all very sort of dreamlike and sort of, oh, I don't know, I'm trying to think of the word, but...
pretentious.
Well, yeah, quite pretentious, but, you know, sort of transient and...
I think that almost goes with the territory for some of this music.
But, you know, it's fucking post-rock, you know, what do you expect?
Well... This is kind of what we had to touch on, right? So, like, in terms of what we're dealing with here, I don't think this is post-rock. I think this is post-metal, right?
I would say it's probably half and half.
And I would love to, like, dig into that a wee bit.
Okay, I'd love to.
That's probably a distinction that maybe we take it for granted, how many people will even know what we're talking about here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But, so, for me, like, when I listen to this, obviously there's a lot of prog in it. I hear hints of some of what Cave-In did, especially, for example, when they use, like, acoustic guitars. That then segue into super crunchy heavy bits. There's a lot of that kind of stuff. There are loads of references to bands like Cult of Luna, obviously. Even in moments, attempts to kind of tap into like the super nastiness of stuff like Charger. But obviously not as brutal or nihilistic as that. It's like a bit more structured and within the kind of the trappings of polished, and as you say, post-rocky hints. Because it is at times almost as close to Explosions in the Sky as it is to something like that. From the description you gave us before it, and from just reading a bit about them before I'd really dug into their back catalogue, I expected something a lot lighter than this was. It does get...
Well, I think part of what I like about it is the fact that it covers such a wide variety of sounds. You know, it does go from really light to really heavy.
Yeah, I mean, I have to say, like, for me, one of the big weaknesses of this band for me is the excessive use of acoustic guitars. There's something in that that lends itself to criticism of the band as being a bit corny. It's a very, very fine, it's a big jump in the shark thing, but it's just crossing too far into prog when you start bringing acoustic guitars into like metal. And it's just a bit sort of, oh, come on, give us a break. But at the same time, I think there's a lot to take away for the band. I mean, Dave, you're a big post-metal guy. I know, Mark, I know you dabble a wee bit in it.
He's a dabbler.
So, like, post-metal, post-rock wise was like an extension of what Lift Experience, Godspeed You Black Emperor, Mogwai especially were doing, where they'd taken this experimental rock stuff, but then it was played at such volume and with such intensity that it started to become almost metallic in the weight of the sound. And then that married with a lot of much more traditional metal influences. As I understand it, the 96 album Through Silver and Blood by Neurosis is considered by some as like the original
post-metal.
Yeah, so it was like their fifth album, I think.
Yeah.
And like people like Terrorizer and Fact Magazine still call that not only the original, but still debatably the best or one of the best.
It's a phenomenal record, to be fair.
Yeah. And post-metal also, when we're trying to like come to some agreement on what it means, I think there tends to be an agreement that it rejects some metal tropes, like even just the style of dress. It seemed to have a lot more in common. We spoke about it in Botch and Converge. People not wearing all black with long hair and pointed guitars. There was something a bit less tropey about it.
Yeah, certainly one of the first bands that, you know, started off as a post-metal band and sort of defined post-metal were Isis, and they were contemporaries of, you know, Botch and Converge.
They were one of the big breakthrough acts, I think. Yeah, absolutely. And a lot of stuff gets compared back to them. Even like Cult of Luna now is very heavily influenced by Isis, for example. We do have to, in the modern world, differentiate between Isis the band
and Isis the dog in Downton Abbey.
Exactly.
Yes, exactly.
Big problem. Another band that I kind of came across, I'm going to look into them a bit more, but when I was reading about the kind of prehistory of post-metal, if you will, a band called Agaloch or Agaloch. I don't know how they pronounce it, because they're not Scottish.
They always get mentioned. So I never really got into them, but...
A-G-A-L-L-O-C-H, and they're a band from Portland and Oregon, and they're seen as one of the first bands to, especially as regards post-metal, to go towards the black metal-y or the more extreme side of post-metal, because there was stuff that was just very loud post-rock, but then these kind of Scandinavian symphonic sort of saturated influences started to appear, especially like things like the high-pitched screaming vocals sunk down into the mix. That became a feature for a lot of people. Also, by the way, I don't know, Agaloch used a deer skull on one of their albums, and I wanted to ask, can you as a vegan buy an album that's had a deer skull played on it? Is that any different from buying jelly babies that I've got?
That's a good point.
Or gelatin.
So every time I stream that on Spotify, I'm breaking vegan.
That has a non-vegan product in it.
It depends if it was sourced ethically or not.
I mean, if it was found in the forest. So yeah. We're agreeing that finally that carrion is vegan.
It is for me. I always eat every corpse I find.
So, you know. So you keep the countryside tidy. You're going to get so fat after Brexit. You're the only guy over here putting on weight. Looking at some of the bands that are like highlights of the scene, I mean, Godflesh, their second album, Pure. Godflesh, which is basically Justin Broderick, who's one of the only people in post-metal that's actually British, or at least one of the only big names in post-metal who's British.
But just Jesu as well.
Yeah, Justin Broderick went on to do Jesu, or Jesu, I don't know how they pronounce
Jesu
it.
Jesu were basically his post-metal project.
Yeah, and it was a lot more, like Godflesh came from this industrial thing and then started to come up with some of these ideas that started to reappear in other people's records, but Jesu or Jesu was much more kind of sort of experimental and trippy and...
Yeah, a bit more ambient, a bit more droney.
Yeah,
also a bit more sort of poppy as well. At points, he took like really sort of naive melodies and put them into this really sort of atmospheric place. Like, some Jesus is really, really good.
Yeah, it's an interesting listen. It's quite challenging. And there's a lot in this, actually, and I could actually see us doing like a special on this at one point alone. But
well, there's a few records that I will definitely bring forward to the table.
There's loads. I mean, entrenched see, in just going through some of the names, like Neurosis' third album, Souls at Zero, is a great example of a band starting to move in an interesting direction, and it's an excellent album. You've got bands like The Ocean. You've got bands like Earth. They're kind of on the fringes of it because some of their stuff is certainly not post-metal, but some of it really was, or at least some of it.
Yeah, they were. I mean, they started as a drone band, but yeah. I mean, that's a touchstone of all post-metal.
Yeah, and
anyway,
stuff
so.
Like Sun as well became, you know, on the periphery of post-metal. You've got Russian Circles, who are like one of the most highly regarded. Another name that come up a lot, albeit I've seen Pelican and I don't massively rate Pelican, I'll be honest with you.
Although
Australasia's very
early Pelican has some amazing riffs. Their drummer is
terrible.
Awful.
What is with that?
Really bad. He just can't drum.
I mean, seeing him live, it was really embarrassing. And it's like, you guys must know.
But do you know what? I was in Boston on holiday. It was, must have been 10 years ago, I think, because I'd just left uni. And Pelican and Isis played together and I went to see them. And this was towards the end of Isis's career.
We're talking about Isis, the terrorist organization.
Yeah. Right, okay. So I mean, we all know their later work just really went downhill.
I'm just gonna say the security in the club that night must
I mean I was looking forward to Isis so much because Oceanic and Panopticon are like two of my all-time favorite records.
Yeah.
And Pelican I'd always liked, but Isis, you know, were definitely the band for me. But Pelican blew Isis out of the water that night.
Wow.
They just sounded like a band that were enjoying themselves and they were like in it. They had like fucking riffs all over the place. And then Isis were just way too tight and too rehearsed and not organic at all.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
They sounded like a really boring tool, basically.
That's interesting. So, because that was the point where Isis had become almost very clinical. And
last Isis record, I just find incredibly
dull. Yeah, they totally passed their kind of Goldilocks zone of, you know, naive enough, but getting very, very competent. Yeah, and other bands that pop up as well are bands like Death Heaven, who were credited as having started this black wave, this sort of mixture of like black metal and shoegaze and no wave sort of stuff. Albeit David and Mark know my opinions on Death Heaven and they're not nearly as positive as most other people's.
They are incorrect.
And a band that I think probably deserve a bit more attention are Wolves in the Throne Room. I would call
them a black metal band.
No, we'll see. I think Wolves.
I mean, their first two records are definitely black metal,
but they're a band that moved in a direction that was far more sprawling. And I think, see, if you're talking about the defining characteristics of this, I mean, the ones that were given that were obvious were like heavy, aggressive, dark in tone, and characterized by a lot of crescendos, which is something that this album that we're talking about today has. But also, you know, like, always amplified. The songs are generally quite long. The sounds like very expansive and atmospheric. they incorporate elements of doom quite often. There's also a lot of math moments incorporated into post-metal, including like unusual timings, very, very large sections, sometimes entire tracks that are in minimalism and ambient experimentation. There's electronica involved, including some of the bands we've mentioned, where they start to bring in synths and stuff. Isis did a lot of that. Then it builds upon not just the post-rock and post-hardcore kind of frameworks. It incorporates all these other elements of, like I said, like the electronics, the ambient, the doom, other ingredients. It's quite a rich vein of music.
And another band that I'd highly recommend anybody check out is a French band called Year of No Light.
Year of No Light is really good.
They're fucking incredible.
Oh, while we're throwing in recommendations, Monarch. And Amun-Ra, I think.
Yeah. I've never particularly got into Amun-Ra. They played with Boris last year and headlined, and I kind of find that odd because Boris were much better.
Boris are a band that are weirdly tied in with the post-metal thing because there's so much of their experiment stuff, so much of their music is so different, but it's an interesting genre. And I think, I mean, as I'm saying, when it comes to Shels, I think some of their stuff was the right mix of that. I love Shels when they're heavy. I thought they're really good at that.
They sound like Deftones.
I mean, the singing, yeah, the singing stuff, like, so yeah, there's moments of singing in this that we'll touch on, but just musically speaking, when they're heavy, I think they're at their best, and especially when they're heavy and they've got that kind of vocal sunk into the mix, either screamed or roared, you know, the various ranges, I think that is what works the best. And some of the subdued bits are okay, but when they lapse into like the strummy stuff, they lose me a wee bit because it becomes a bit too corny. That's the only word I can think of for it. I just can't really get with that. Again, somebody putting on a 12-string.
Well, we'll discuss this when we come to the record, I think, because I think for me, that's a lot of the charm in this record is that they just do it anyway. They do things that other bands might not pull off and they might come off as cheesy, but for me, it works out.
I would agree with that to some extent, but my caveat would be that the album, that the final album they released, Plains of the Purple Buffalo, 2011, I prefer that album. I actually really quite like that record. I thought like the first track, Journey to the Plains, has some great moments in it.
Yeah, that's a fucking brilliant track.
Cyclical riff thing that starts later on in that track. The third track, the title track, has this weird Morricone thing with trumpets. The sound in that album, I think, is bigger. It's a bit more cinematic. I think like the fifth track, Vision Quest, is a good example of that. It's also quite upbeat. It has like that kind of posy metal feel to it, which is a bit reminiscent of Explosions in the Sky, who I'm not a big fan of by any means, but it was well tempered by there's a track on that, the eighth one, called Crown of Eagle Feathers, which is the kind of most black metal of almost anything they've done, that song, and that for me is the best song the band have released. Really, really good, really dark, and brings together a lot of these elements and kind of eschews some of the cheesier moments that they have in this album. So I don't disagree. I really like them. in theory, I'm just not sure about the ratios on the album that you've picked.
Yeah.
It jars me a wee bit. It pulls me out too often, I think.
Well, let's talk about that. We haven't done our Nexus yet.
Oh, shit.
We haven't done our normal schedule here.
Well, since the show's largely rapidly becoming about the Nexus.
Yeah, no, exactly.
It's
come
edging
on.
Towards the end.
Give the people what they want.
Okay, well, a bit of music to lead us into the Nexus then.
It's the Unsung Podcast. Dave Grohl Nexus. Need to find a way to connect the show to that guy.
And I went first last week, so one of you guys can take the lead.
I mean, I'll take the lead and do a simple. It's fairly simple, but okay.
Mine is not simple.
So as mentioned, Shels released their first record on Shels Music, but also with help from Undergroove Records.
You bastard!
Oh, you bastard!
See, we've all done the same one, have we?
This is going to be interesting.
There's a lot
Undergroove
of
Records released Raging Speedhorn.
I don't know that.
Okay, remember Raging Speedhorn?
We've branched off at the first
some
step.
Absolute. I mean, that first Raging Speedhorn record is actually fucking great.
Raging Speedhorn, despite being giant meatheads, do kind of kill it.
Yeah, totally. Yeah.
The only problem is Raging Speedhorn consistently got shat on by Charger.
Aye. Yeah, that's true. I know. Raging Speedhorn went on tour with loads of bands in the late 90s and early 2000s.
He certainly did. Mm. Including some absolute hummers.
Like Earth Tone 9, who are a fucking brilliant band.
Oh my god. The bubble wrap album.
Will Haven, Skindred, Kitty, Defenestration, Biohazard.
Oh my god.
Slipknot. Amen.
Raging as mentioned Speedhorn, last year. You shameless prostitutes, you.
But it's just because like they were the only one of the only actually decent heavy bands in Britain. You know, at the time.
They're also one of those bands that when a band wants credibility and they're a naff new metal band, they're like, give us a decent support so that we look a little bit edgy.
Aye. Anyway, they then toured in 2001 with Mudvayne.
You said that like you were at it.
No, they did. And LD50, an underrated record, by the way.
That's so big.
Dig was the classic club anthem.
Bada, 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 bada,
but there's
bada,
a couple
bada.
Of fucking great tracks on that. Nothing Again is an absolute belter. Anyway, that album was produced by Garth.
Garth.
Which brings us out to a lot of 90s.
So many.
A lot of 90s. So many 90s.
So you could take your pick from, you know, to get to Nirvana from here. Stuff like... I don't know. It's all shit, isn't it?
Curb Dog.
Yeah, Curb Dog.
Wait, did the fuck did the album?
He did three fucking Biffy records, didn't he?
No, that was Colin.
What does Biffy Clyro have to do with Nirvana other than the fact
exactly.
That was Colin Richardson, not Garth Richardson.
Really?
It was Colin Richardson, yeah.
Well, maybe he worked on... It's listed...
Is it?
Biffy is listed in his list. But anyway, I went for L7. He did...
really easy to get to Nirvana for.
Yeah, Hungry for Stink. And then, I mean, L7 toured with Nirvana, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
Dave Grohl was in Nirvana.
Safe bet.
Yep, good one. Okay, I'll
Mark,
go.
Okay, so we know that it's via Undergroove.
Via Undergroove. So, as Dave mentioned, Undergroove released a whole bunch of records, some really cool ones and some really weird ones, including a record by Sorry and the Snatchers. a band formed by Scott Sorry, who was former member of Amen and the Wild Hearts. He's also a really good friend of a friend of mine, and he is unfortunately battling with a brain tumor right now. But he really did a GoFundMe and they released, and they raised a lot of money and did a lot of beneficials, and the outlook is pretty good. So, you know, a lot of positivity there.
That's good.
I would appreciate you warning me so that I don't giggle immediately before you give us, like, drop a bomb like that.
Sorry.
Scott, sorry.
As a member of AMN, he was also in the same band as Casey Chaos, of course.
Yeah.
Did we not talk about Casey Chaos last week?
Yeah, two episodes in a row.
I.e. an hour ago.
And Casey Chaos appears on the truly, truly awful third Vanilla Ice album called...
Fuck off, really?
That's amazing.
Called Hard to Swallow, which is a new metal record.
Right? Oh, I forgot he did a new metal record.
Produced by Ross Robinson, no less.
The name is very Hard to Swallow. Jesus. That's perfect.
It's hard. It's an album which also features Sonny Mayo, who's a Johnny May guitarist.
Yeah, was he not in
with the likes of Godsmack?
Machine Head, maybe?
No, he was in Godsmack.
It's weird, we were talking about Mayo earlier.
Yeah. Hey, eggs.
How do we feel about the consistency of Sonny Mayo?
well, you're going to find out about how consistent his career's been. So he's been in Godsmack, Snot, Ted P.E.
Godsmack.
And Ugly Kid Joe. Playing drums on that record is also Shannon Larkin, who is one of the founding members of Godsmack and has also been in Ugly Kid Joe, Amen and Snot. So the whole thing comes full circle.
Nasty family.
And the record Motel California by Ugly Kid Joe features Lemmy on some guest vocals. And Lemmy was in Probot with Dave Grohl.
Of course.
All right.
Well, oh, Vanilla Ice.
Did either of you guys take note of how many stages you went through?
Yeah, I've got it written down.
There's a few.
Mine's 12.
Okay, let's go.
Mine's 5.
So Shels released their first album in partnership with Undergroove Records, who you both have mentioned. Undergroove Records released albums by Take a Worm for a Walk Week. Brief Glasgow Institution, they released records by Charger, Coexist, another Glaswegian cult outfit, and Aerogram.
Glaswegian cult outfit.
Aerogram, another, a very, very common reference point if you're Scottish. Aerogram, the bassist in that band was a guy called Campbell McNeil, a big, beardy, surly fellow who also worked for a while as a sound engineer in the Barfly in Glasgow. Campbell McNeil was... to some extent, I hesitate to make it too official, but the manager of Churches before Churches were Churches, and then continued to play a role with the band to some extent. I'm not sure what, but he kind of got into that as a on the back of a tour where he was the tour manager for the musician Gautier. And Gautier released that fantastic song, his only song, despite having multiple other albums, Somebody That I Used to Know. The tune that sounds a bit like a slightly more anemic version of Sting. Which won, manner awards, which is mental. He also, small fact, Gautier's real name, Wally DeBacker. Brilliant. Wally DeBacker played as Gautier on Saturday Night Live in 2012. Also on that show as a guest was Josh Brolin. Josh Brolin, other than acting in the film No Country for Old Men,
W,
which could have been a link to Obama and
Goonies,
and Avengers as Thanos, all of them, but The Goonies, as Dave says.
Oh.
The soundtrack to The Goonies, the theme tune was The Goonies Are Good Enough. The absolute absolutely amazing, Cyndi Lauper said with no irony whatsoever. Because
I mean, she is obviously great.
Fucking brilliant. Cyndi Lauper also covered the song I Drove All Night, the world's most creepy rape song, sung by a semi-blind man called Roy Orbison.
Mm-hmm. Second most creepy rape song, right? The first one's got to be that Sting song, Every Step You Take, Every Breath You Take. That's a pretty creepy.
Really? I drove all night, crept in your room to make love to you. Is that all right?
I didn't say it was okay. I said probably the second
the fact
most
that he asks at the end of it, not at the start of it, is it all right? Is it all right if I creep in your room
and make love to you? Am I okay to be here?
It's more like, I just crept in your room and made love to you. Was that okay?
Are we cool with this?
Anyway, Roy Orbison and friends, A Black and White Night is a feature-length concert of Roy Orbison performance with an all-star cast band behind them, including Tom Waits, Bruce Springsteen, K.D. Lang, and Elvis Costello. Interesting fact, in the audience for that film was...
In the audience. It's like, and this person just watched this film at one point.
No, in the audience of the filming.
Right, okay, like, yeah, I'm joking.
Right, was Mr. David Lynch. And David Lynch, big Roy Orbison fan, he'd also used In Dreams in the film Blue Velvet. David Lynch released a really pretty decent album called Crazy Clown Time, of like this weird kind of post-punk electro stuff.
Yeah, it's pretty good.
A track on that called Pinky's Dream, which is a really good song, features the singer Karen O. In 2018, Karen O, as part of her band the Yeah Yeah Yeahs, appeared alongside Dave Grohl at a thing called the Swing Left Midterm Democratic Fundraiser in the States to try and help get more Democratic candidates elected. Grohl, by the way, was playing drums for Beck on Devil's Haircut.
Great. Bunch of lefties there.
Lefties, yeah.
Well,
there you go.
Centers.
Big Gammon involved.
Told you that was a banger.
That was long.
Mm-hmm.
Thanks.
Some good jumps though.
No, it was good. Enjoyed that. Okay, let's get back to it.
All right, you guys ready? Are you ready? Here we go.
All right.
Thanks, Fraser. As always.
As always.
So, Sea of the Dying Dhow.
Yeah.
2007.
So you've already mentioned that some of the moments on this are a bit cheesy.
I mean, we can skip through it. The Conference of the Birds, first track.
I mean, it's a big sort of introduction to the entire sort of soundscape that you're expecting. I mean, at the same time, I mentioned the band Latitudes, which came out, and that's like a far more simple sort of two guitars, bass, drums, post-metal, post-rock, 10-minute duration, but it doesn't
This band is, like, I've seen live videos of Shells playing, there was seven of them at one point.
Yeah. Well, that's the whole point. There's a lot more happening than on your sort of generic, your Russian Circles, your ISIS even.
Mm. Well, they've got a trumpet player for starters.
Yeah, exactly. Mm. So Conference of the Birds, it builds up. I think that 6-minute introduction of the trumpet.
Yeah.
Really, it's quite euphoric. It's quite something. You know, I love that when it comes in. It is like a signal, this album's a bit weird. We're just going where we want.
The production in that track is amazing.
The guitar sounds are so good.
It's really good sounding record. Only like this track I find a bit predictable. I find it like a bit strummy and it's like a little bit of a workout. But I get that
they take their time getting there, definitely. There's like a couple of tracks on this when they're going through that acoustic-y strummy bit. I hate to say the word plod, but if you're being unkind, it could plod, but to me it doesn't plod at all. I think it is building up there. It's doing that sort of post-rock, you know, dynamic sort of thing.
I also get that your first track should probably be a fairly representative balance of your influences in some ways. That's like a nice, when it's a 10-minute song, it's probably good to touch on a lot of different
areas. Exactly, you know, it's got a lot of the sort of acoustic instruments in there, but then, as mentioned, you know, that guitar sound, the big open overdriven stuff.
Oh yeah,
but just sounds incredible.
But again, when they let rip, I think they're really good at it.
Yeah, and then at the end of this record, the end of this song, you've got those scream vocals in the background.
Yeah, which is them at their strongest.
Yeah,
I think.
And yeah. The chug comes in and the
bit Will Haven-y sound in.
Yeah, exactly. And I think they would definitely say that was an influence as well.
I think the band overuse 3/3 timing a little bit. It pops up a whole bunch of times in this record, and coupled with the acoustic guitar, it's a little bit like this again. Like, as a writer, it bugs me a little bit, but you know, I'm just maybe being a bit pernickety.
I found the same thing as well. We kept going back to that same motif. I was like, oh, we're here again.
Indian One, the second track, does that as well, does the 3/3 thing. It's got that really kind of post-rock crescendo. Although I do like... It's slightly more metallic in its approach to it's almost like if explosions in the sky were more interesting.
Exactly.
It has the euphoric thing, but it's done in a slightly more rewarding way. Is it White Umbrella? There's just an intro. It's like an ambient piece, number 3, before it goes into the White Umbrella.
Yeah, White Umbrella part 1, and then White Umbrella, and then it just kicks off.
That's the heaviest tune, right?
Absolute chug.
Yeah. The tones in that are massive.
Yes. Like, and then, you know, it just starts like that and you're like, holy fuck. And then
drops
totally,
it,
totally
it?
Plays about with like your usual arrangements, and it drops out, then
it's
slowly
like
builds
guitar
again.
And piano, isn't it?
Yeah, it's got that dee 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 doo sort of piano that comes in.
A bunch of really nice like counter melodies going on.
Yeah. And there's like some really nice chord progressions happening. I think it's just really, really warm. And by the time, you know, by the time the last crescendo builds up, there's just such a lot of nice sounds, you know. Mm-hmm. And you know what is better in music than lots of nice sounds?
I mean, that is the reducto ad absurdum of post rock, though. Is just like a growing mesh of nice sounds.
Then, you know, once again, then it just drops out again and goes into that massive chug and the scream, and it's
big evil bit
so fucking heavy.
You really know how the end songs on this record. Like,
yeah,
the ends
yeah.
of pretty much all the songs are pretty impressive, I think.
I think this is a point, though, where we may diverge, because track 5, Water, is very much a sung, it's like a song song.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Almost sounds like a different band.
It sounds like the vocal is a Biffy Clyro vocal.
It's very British. This is one thing you've spoken about this in the past, about how you hear vocal lines and melody lines, or even just melody sort of themes, that are much more distinctly British than they are American.
Yeah, totally.
And this sounds like a British melodic vocal.
It sounds like fucking Your Three Colours Red or something like that. It's post-grungy type.
It reminded me of some of the Your Codename Is Milo choices, like music, like in terms of the direction of the vocal line, and maybe to some extent like Hell Is For Heroes or something like that as well. I don't like this song. I think I see what it's trying to do. I don't think it needs to be in this album. I think it's a bit corny.
I don't know. I feel like it's like a deliberate sort of naive counterpoint to the rest of the record that I think works really well in the middle.
It's definitely, yeah, it's definitely,
it's like
variation.
Here is a big fucking chorus, you know, major keys in there, and it's like, I don't know, I just think it stretches what this album is.
But this is, so here's what I say. I agree, when you put something into an album that's distinct and expands the scope of that album, such as at the end of the Bronx album, that track that's a bit more at the drive-in, that's one thing. Vocals are such a big ingredient, right? And they engage your brain in such a way, and they define what you're listening to in such a way. If you have an album that is a vocal, not led, but this track is definitely vocal led,
yeah,
then you relate to it in a different way than you relate to music if it's non-vocally led. Not just because vocal isn't just an instrument, it's got other aspects that activate areas in our brain and pull us out of the music in a way. Mm. I don't think, it's not like throwing in a harmonica or throwing in a cello. For me, throwing in a vocal completely upsets the balance of what you're doing. And if your vocal's in the background and your vocal is an instrument, such as in like black metal or such as in a lot of doom, where the vocal is really just an atmospheric tool, that's one thing. But if you then completely change the nature, and you only do it once or twice, I think it is, because there's a track later on that has quite a lot of vocal in it, it just to me sounds inconsistent. It doesn't add to it in the same way as like another instrument, like a piano or, you know, a glockenspiel or something would do. I think vocals are a separate thing entirely, and they change the nature of what you're doing. And for me, it just doesn't fit with the rest of what they're trying to do. I think I would have liked the rest of the album more if that hadn't been on it. That's just my feeling on
it. Yeah, no, it's interesting you say that. And I do always remember like listening to, I mean, I got this album when it came out, and I listened to it fucking constantly on CD and had it on repeat, along with about, you know, like four or five records in the car, like you used to. You'd have like your five CDs on rotation. And I think maybe this was the track that I skipped when I had it, but given context and looking back at it 12 years later, I go back and look at it and listen to it, and it doesn't feel out of place. Like, I don't know, it somehow feels like a nice kind of naive part of the record that belongs there, which, and maybe when I was, you know, 20 when this came out and I thought it was cheesy and thought I was cool, I didn't like it, but now I don't care.
The cynical part of me says that I suspect that perhaps they wanted something on here that could in some way be akin to a single. I think they wanted something that could be like a flagship, something that had a relatability.
Yeah.
And
accessible.
Mm. I think this is far.
You said earlier that it's maybe kind of Deftones-y.
Yeah, I mean, that big riff at the start, like the kind of open kind of.
Yeah, it could be like
it's definitely
one of the more ballady Deftones, like but it's Be Quiet and Drive.
It's
for
way too long, though. It's way too long for that. And
it was never going to be a single. And that's why I don't think they were aiming it as a single.
The song's 5 minutes long, though. It's the shortest song on the record.
Well, the full version is 6.5. So we find it. Yeah, I mean, I just think it's a misfire for me in the context of the album. I think the album would have made more sense and flowed better without that suddenly synaptic interruption of like, oh, somebody's trying to speak to me, rather than the vocals being in the mix as an instrument, as like a harmony or a growl or a scream.
Yeah.
Suddenly they're trying to actually speak to me, and it's like, I'm trying to listen to music, stop talking to me.
Yeah, I understand. It's just interesting going back, and I do kind of remember, didn't mind this track when I first heard it, but then, you know, on repeated listens, this would probably be the one I'd skip because I wanted to hear the chuggy bit.
Yeah.
But going back to it, I didn't have that thought. And I knew that this was the track that you'd pick up on because it does stand out and it doesn't necessarily fit. But it's interesting that I am far more forgiving to it now than I was, you know, when the record came out.
Man, your drive through the Highlands, so it must have been cheery affairs, eh?
Uh-huh. Oh, man, those were the days. I had a summer job working in the post office sorting factory from midnight till 5 a.m.
Wow.
But it never gets dark. It gets dark at 1 a.m. and gets light at 3 a.m.
Yeah. Must have been beautiful, though.
It was fucking amazing.
Yeah.
And like, listening to this record, driving my mum's Toyota Yaris, about 95, getting home in about 10 minutes. If you listen to this record, it's great.
Yeah, if you'd
have time for one song.
If you're listening to this podcast abroad or even much further south and you've never been in the Northern Hemisphere,
Google it.
When it doesn't ever really quite get that dark.
And yeah, particularly like in Inverness and the Highlands.
The scenery is just amazing. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, basically in June, the sun skims the horizon about 1 a.m. and then pops back up. But it is, it's a good time.
Dramatic
of year.
Landscape, we had an interesting
way. Whereas this time of year, the sun pops out of the horizon for about 4 minutes at 2 p.m. and that's it.
That's why we're all so unwell.
Yeah.
But by contrast, I think, see the sixth track, the one immediately after this, the title track, Sea of the Dying Dhow.
Yeah.
I think that's probably the best song on it. Really metallic in the middle. So
it's kind of Meshuggah-y. It's got that 5/4.
It's dead strong.
Breakdown.
And it's much more brittle. And as I said, way, way back at the start of this, I like that. I like it when they really commit to the brutality of the music. I think they're good at that.
And it fades out and it gets swallowed at the end, but it kind of makes you want to just put it on again.
And then we've got the obligatory Atoll, which, as I said, is on every single one of
which is just like a sort of little 40-second track.
It's so short that I actually forgot to write a note for it.
Yeah, that's fine.
Sorry.
I feel like a lot of this is kind of ambient-y sort of mixtures anyway.
Yeah. The Kill Intent's interesting because it marks a really odd end to the album, because the album sort of starts to go off this like weird acoustic prog.
Yeah, for the next like three tracks.
Like it actually, I kept expecting one of these tracks to burst back into volume, and for like three songs, it's like no, we're not going to do that for a while.
Yeah,
and okay, I get that they're trying to buck the trend of maybe earlier on, but I actually think as a result, these are kind of some of the weaker songs on it. The Kill Intent is fine. It goes back to the waltz thing. It's got some nice guitar in it. The picking is pretty good. It's got a really kind of Celtic rhythm to it almost. First one with like a kind of 70s vibe, I felt as well.
Yeah.
I also like the fact that they kept in these really noisy fret squeaks, you know, when you're moving your hand up and down.
The mic is obviously just placed right in front of that.
I like that part of it in the production, but the fact that it's then followed by Indian 2, which is another strummy kind of prog track,
kind of Thule almost, like bits
of cave in as well, man. And like, and then the 10th one again is it Return to Gulu? Is anybody,
yeah, that's another Gulu, another big slow lad. And if it was earlier on in the album, there'd be a big
explosion,
distorted, open chordy bit at the end. But this kind of teases you.
I like both of those songs.
I really do like them.
I really dug them.
And I think they fit because I think they're all kind of building up to the last track, which in itself is mostly a build up. But I mean,
that's exactly it. I think it's something of an anticlimax because for me, you've played your best song, number 6, See the Dying Dhow, which I think is excellent. And then you've done an ambient tune, a strummy tune, a strummy tune, a strummy tune, and then the 11th track in Dead Palm Fields, is that what it's called?
Yeah.
Again, you're back into 3/3. Yeah, it's kind of epic and it shifts over to 4/4, but it doesn't do it as well as a couple of the earlier songs. And even though it's quite abrasive and more abrasive than some of the others, and it's that kind of fake ending, I just think the whole thing kind of ends on leaves me with that kind of...
I don't know. I think it ends on one of my favourite riffs of all time.
That's a good riff.
It sort of collects everything that you've got from the album so far. It takes like some of the motifs that you've had, and you've got your acoustics coming at the 4, then it comes back to the big 4/4 rhythm. Then it goes quiet. You know, you're sort of 4.5 minutes in, and then the sort of scream comes in, and you're like, this is abrasive. This is more sort of hardcore. You can kind of hear the Eden Maine sort of stuff. Drums feels sort of urgent and come in, and the sort of, you know, scrapey guitar, but then you've just got this massive sort of post-metal riff. Only does it four times. Like, they don't,
they don't
like keep doing and fade out like they do on See the Dying Dhow. They just like do it four times and then that's it.
Yeah. Then you've got a false ending, then a kind of little, kind of bit.
Well, yeah, and then just the ambience.
Like, I just track at the end.
See, if you can see the Dying Dhow, obviously track 6 out of 11 is basically the pivot for this album. And I think if you put it on that, the album topples in the side, in the direction of the first side. I just think it's stronger.
I think the riff at 6:48 on track 11 is strong enough. It's like this big fucking column of riff that the album can stand.
It's a nugget of solid riff.
A bookend. I don't know, man.
I don't know. It was interesting going back to this record, because I fucking loved this record when it came out, and I don't think there's a lot that sounds like it, and I don't think it sounds like a lot of things.
I think it sounds like, I mean, to be fair to it, there's a lot that's come since, because that was 12 years ago now. I think it sounds like elements of some very good bands. I think some of the aspects of it have been done much better. As I said, though, in terms of the band, I like a lot of what the band are doing. I think I preferred Plains of the Purple Buffalo as a record, but I do. I would put it in, because I think there,
as a debut album of a band that has a lot of personality and interesting things happening,
it's a high quality record. I think it's a higher quality record than, I mean, we mentioned Aerogram. It's a higher quality record than stuff they've done, and mm-hmm. they've got loads of credit for it. So I mean, the fact that Shels are still so under-recognised suggests they deserve more attention, but I think they deserve to be in. So if this is the one that goes in, I would back it. I would have personally picked the last album, and I think if you do like this, then I would encourage you to check out the Purple Buffalo album.
I just don't think Purple Buffalo adds enough. I think there's way more going on with this.
That's the point. I think it's more focused. I like that.
Mm. I think I love that first track on Plains of the Purple.
There's loads of good tracks in that. I think the thing with Buffalo is they've managed to sort of shed a lot of moments of the things that I personally think they're weaker at.
Yeah.
I think they've identified their strengths a bit better and they've focused more on them. And I do agree it's less varied, but I think it's a more consistent album as a result. And it's good when a band's most recent album is its best album, albeit they're not doing stuff now.
What are your thoughts, Mark?
Very interesting.
That's all I have to say on that. You know, I like this record. I think I need to be in the right headspace for this kind of music. As it stands, I think this record has got more character than Plains of the Purple Buffalo. But I do also think, Chris, that you're right. I think there's more consistency to be found on that. But
character can be bad.
Well,
zany.
It can be, like, it's clearly
like a loads of characters I hate. Yeah. I never liked Will and Grace. I didn't like anybody in Will and Grace.
I don't think you were supposed to.
Oh, I don't know about that. Sorry, carry on.
I think this is a little bit eccentric, this record. I think it's a band trying things, and sometimes they fail at those things, and I've brought records on here before which do similar things. I really appreciate that in a band. I like a band that takes risks.
Yeah, it's like watching a film that isn't perfect but does weird things just to try them out. I'd rather watch a band overexert themselves and fail than stick to all the rules.
I could easily have made another kind of Mogwai rip-off record with just some heavy bits in it, which they could quite like. There's moments on this record.
You mean like Mogwai?
Yeah. Like Mogwai doing it. There's elements on this record which I think could be like, you know, Isis playing Mogwai. You can hear it about to happen, but then they do something a bit different. But they also bring in some of the worst elements of prog, which is like the acoustic guitar parts, which, albeit I like the songs which are mostly all acoustic, I think plonking them in the middle of some songs can sometimes rob them of the power. I think there's other interesting ways you can do that, but that's got its own charm as well, and I like that. And like you said, 12 years ago, this record came out 12 years ago, and not a lot of people were doing this back then. Maybe upon reflection, maybe as we look back at it now, knowing what we know, I think some of it hasn't aged particularly well because there's bands that have done it better now.
I would agree. I would concede as well that in terms of unsung, the ambition of a band can be unsung in a similar way to the achievements of a band being unsung. And I think the ambition of the band is admirable. I just also feel that one of the things that marks a great album is a band knowing its strengths and its weaknesses and making, we talked about brevity, we've talked about how focused a product is. I think, yes, it's less, maybe less ambitious, but for me, less ambitious equates with more focused, but it's horses for courses. I mean, you guys like this one, I do like the band. I don't think they're the best post-metal band ever, but I think given their under-recognition, they deserve a shout. And, you know, there's definitely moments on it, even somebody that's into very heavy music will find something on this that they enjoy.
Mm-hmm. Great.
It's a decent choice. It's a left field choice, but yeah, it was rewarding listening. There's definitely a couple of tracks by them that I'll hang on to as well, specifically that I thought were really good.
Yeah, and then it's worth going through the Shels music catalogue as well.
Yeah, the label is really interesting.
Yeah, that second, the first, the Admiral Angry, is that the only album? Or was
they did a second, like one track record that was like 15 minutes long.
That first Admiral Angry album is utterly amazing.
Yeah, and Black Sheep Wall as well, if you like sludge. Anyway, yeah, so Shels, See the Dying Dhow. Go do your Facebook voting if you like that sort of shit. Chris, what are we doing next week?
Next week, I'm going to take a wee burl at something with a huge back catalogue. I'm a big fan of Tori Amos. Tori Amos, in most cases, wouldn't maybe necessarily qualify for this, but I think she has an album called Tales from the Quergal Hotel? Motel? I can't remember. One of the two. That is reasonably well regarded, but not nearly as well regarded as it should be, especially in relation to some of her other catalogue, which is much more commonly topping lists and sales figures. So yeah, we're going to go for that. It's a fair bit of work though, because she's got a lot of stuff, and I'd like to kind of give a fairly representative history of what she's done, but we'll try and not stretch it out too far.
Cool. Well,
magic.
Thank you very much, guys.